Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cousins by Aurora Venturini. Introduction by Mariana Enriquez. Translated by Kit Maud. Narrated by Sol Madariaga.
Introduction. It was cold, or so my unreliable memory tells me. I was reading in bed with a mug of coffee on the nightstand. The floor was covered with ring-bound entries to the Página 12 newspaper's new novel competition, for which I was working as a preliminary juror, narrowing down the selection for consideration by the jury proper. The manuscript for Las Primas was very different from the others. For a start, it was typewritten, unusual enough by 2007. And to correct her mistakes, the author had used liquid paper that in places had spread over neighboring words as well, but it was still legible. My first encounter with the narrator of Las Primas came as a shock. Heretical syntax, which abhorred punctuation because it exhausted her. Her brutal descriptions of the character's miseries. Her breathtaking mercilessness toward her family. We were unusual. Which is to say, we weren't normal. Says Yuna, the narrator. A young woman with cognitive difficulties. Aurora would never say something so politically correct. She'd say Yuna was a half-wit, whose sister Bettina is bound to a wheelchair by severe physical and mental disabilities, and sometimes needs to be cared for at a specialized institution. Yuna calls it a cotolengo, which is where difficult cases such as her sister were generally sent. It was when I got to one of the scenes set there that I was first moved to ask myself, almost out loud, what on earth is this? Who wrote this book? What's it about? The scene goes like this. As I waited for Bettina's class to finish, I walked around the corridors of the coven. I saw a priest come in accompanied by an altar boy. Someone had given him a sheet. A soul. The priest sprinkled holy water and said that if you have a soul, God welcomes you to his bosom. To what or whom was he talking? I went closer and saw a prominent family from Adrogué. On the table, I saw a cannelloni sitting on top of a silk cushion. It wasn't a cannelloni, but something that had come out of a human womb. Otherwise, the priest wouldn't have baptized it. I made inquiries, and a nurse told me that every year the distinguished couple brought a cannelloni to be baptized. The doctor had advised the mother not to give birth anymore because there was nothing to be done. But they said that as good Catholics, they had to procreate. In spite of my handicap, I knew that this was disgusting, but I couldn't say so. That night, I felt so sick I couldn't eat. I finished the novel, and I think the very next day I called Liliana Viola, another of the pre-jurors, to discuss my surprise. My confusion, my admiration. Was this a brilliant novel? What was so brilliant about it? The risks it takes? The eccentricity? The fact that I'd never seen anything like it? The voice from out of nowhere. Who might the author be? Liliana had read Las Primas too, and was in a similar state, torn between fascination and bewilderment. I think we both knew that if the jury recognized how radical the text and story were, it would have a good chance of winning. And so it did. Aurora Venturini was 85 years old when she won Página 12 New Novel Award. She turned up to the award ceremony with a punk attitude. She had a skinny frame with unusual features arranged into an expression set somewhere between amusement and candor. Her dark, peering eyes, meanwhile, were more like malevolent slits, declaring, "Finally, an honest jury." She had published dozens of books, was a supporter of the Peronist movement, friend of Evita, and went into exile in Paris following the coup of 1955. In France, she became friends with Violette Leduc and socialized with existentialists. Myths gathered around her, and she actively encouraged them during her lifetime. Aurora saw ghosts from a young age. She was friendly with Victoria Ocampo and Borges when she lived in Buenos Aires. When not in exile, she spent 17 years there and the rest of her life in La Plata. She was an obsessive writer and kept spiders as pets. When she fell out of bed and was taken to the hospital with broken bones, she visited hell. And after that, made friends with an exorcist priest. How much of this was true wasn't remotely important, among other things because her books are so authentic. Most of them were published by independent presses or as winners of municipal prizes. And all of them are odd and obsessed with one subject in particular. Family. Las Primas is a story about family and about women. It is, Aurora said, an autobiographical novel. I'm not very family-oriented, I never was, but I always end up writing about my family or families. My creations are all freaks. My family was very freakish. It's what I know. I'm not very ordinary. I'm a strange creature who only wants to write. I'm not very sociable. I only ever see people on December 24th. Las Primas is the monologue of a half-wit, but it's not full of rage, but rather bewilderment, and above all, disgust. The men of the family are absent. The male characters who do appear are abusive and ravage the bodies of vulnerable women with the indifference of petty scoundrels. The story is set in the 40s. The mother is a high-ranking primary school teacher, a prestigious role for a woman, but also one of the few available. Yuna-a manages to escape the house, in her mind at least, because she is a painter. She has talent and is helped by a professor who convinces her to study at art school and exhibit her work. And yet, she is forever bound to the suffering bodies of the women of the family, her aunt, Nene, her cousins, Karina and Petra, and the mild-mannered Rufina in the darkness of a gloomy suburban house where Bettina wheels around, humming and drooling. I painted shadows, which I couldn't help because I have so many shadows inside me that when I get overwrought, item, I drive them out onto my paintings. That item refers to the use of a word, overwrought, that Yuna has looked up in the dictionary because she has a meager vocabulary. She writes against language, against writing conventions, getting the best she can out of her precarious oral skills. In this struggling voice, Yuna describes not just her own coming of age, but also those of the other girls, all of whom are used and neglected. The first to suffer abuse is Karina, one of the cousins. She is impregnated by a neighbor, a potato man, or greengrocer. And Aunt Nene decides that she has to get an abortion. There aren't many abortions in Argentine literature, and here we're giving a vivid account of the shoddiness that comes with illegality. The doctor came, but she didn't look like one. She looked common. She asked which the patient was and how many months, and Aunt Nene answered 3 and change. And I understood why people say that children bring good luck. But Aunt Nene, who didn't eat every day for lack of money, wouldn't pardon the baby even with the change it brought. Come in, said the doctor, and Karina went inside trembling. She asked if her aunt could come too, and the doctor said no, and closed the door to the other room. The metallic screech of the equipment grew more shrill. Karina's abortion doesn't end well, but we won't reveal any more here other than that Petra, Karina's sister, a Lilliputian young woman who starts to work as a prostitute as a teenager, will get her revenge. The cousins Yuna and Petra band together to try to put an end to the chain of abuse from which they, too, have suffered. But nothing is ever enough in this pessimistic, brutal novel with no out-and-out heroines. A novel of extreme, sickly, obsessive, mistreated women. Aurora Venturini loved black humor, cruelty, and monstrosity. She considered herself to be an anomaly and believed in a twisted but playful approach to literature. Las Primas is a novel that makes you laugh out loud with its provocations and unexpected choices. Bodies are pushed to the limit in writing that gushes forth like blood. With Las Primas, Aurora Venturini achieved the acclaim she'd been seeking all her life, and enjoyed it in characteristic fashion. Bearing the scars of the monstrous persona she cultivated with ironic lucidity. Mariana Enriquez. Part 1. A Handicapped Childhood. My mother was a teacher with a white uniform and pointer. She was very strict, but taught well at a school in the suburbs for not very bright children from the middle classes and below. The smartest was Ruben Fiorlandi, the grocer's son. My mother smacked naughty children over the head with her pointer and sent them to sit in the corner wearing donkey's ears she'd made out of colored cardboard. They rarely acted up twice. My mother believed that one learned nothing if the rod was spared. The children in the third grade called her the third grade miss, even though she was married to my father, who left her and never came back to perform his duties as paterfamilias. She did her teaching work in the morning and returned home at 2 in the afternoon. Lunch had already been prepared by Rufina, the northern girl who was our very diligent housekeeper and knew how to cook. I was sick of stew every day. Out back clucked a hen house that laid for us. And in the garden, miraculously golden squashes sprouted suns, dislodged from their celestial home and fallen to earth, growing next to violets and scrawny rose bushes nobody bothered to take care of, but that insisted on adding their perfume to our dingy hovel anyway. I've never told anyone, but I only learned to tell the time from clock faces at the age of 20. I'm surprised and embarrassed to confess it now. Surprised and embarrassed because of what it will tell you about me. And I start to remember all kinds of questions. The question I remember most, particularly, is, what time is it? The truth was that I didn't know the time, and I was as horrified by clocks as I was by my sister's orthopedic wheelchair. She was stupider than me, but she knew how to read clock faces. Not books, though. We were unusual, which is to say we weren't normal. Haram. 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 Babbled Bettina, my sister, as she wheeled her bad luck around the little garden and flagstones of the patio. Her harums were choked with drool. The dodo drooled. Poor Bettina. She was a mistake of nature. Poor me, another mistake. And poor mother, who was burdened with both abandonment and freaks. But anything goes in this filthy world of ours, so there's no use feeling too sorry for anyone or anything. Sometimes I think that we're a dream, or a nightmare, that plays out day after day. But at any given moment, we'll cease to be, vanish from the sheet of our souls, and torture us no longer. Bettina has an emotional disorder. That was the psychologist's diagnosis. I don't know if I've written it right. My sister suffered from a curved spine. From behind sitting down, she looked like a hunchback with stubby legs and extraordinary arms. The old woman who came to darn socks said that mother must have had some harm done to her during pregnancy. Worse with Bettina. I asked the psychologist, a woman with hair on her lip and a monobrow, what emotional meant. She answered that it had to do with your soul, but I was too young to understand. Still, I guessed that a soul was like a white sheet inside our bodies, and when it got stained, it made people stupid. Like Bettina. And a little like me. As Bettina circled the table, humming away, I noticed a little tail poking out through the gap between the back and seat of the orthopedic chair, and said to myself that it must be her soul slipping out. I asked the psychologist another question this time, whether the soul had to do with life, and she said that it did, and then added that when it went away, people died, and the soul went to heaven if they'd been good, or hell if they'd been bad.
Hrum, hrum, hrum.
She continued to drag her soul behind her, and I saw it growing longer every day, encrusted with gray lumps, and so assumed that it would be falling off soon, and Bettina would die. But I didn't care because she disgusted me. At mealtimes, I had to feed my sister, and missed her mouth on purpose and shoved the spoon in her eye, her ear, up her nose, before I got to her gaping maw. Sniveled the dirty creature. I grabbed her by the hair and shoved her face into her food, and that would shut her up. I wasn't to blame for my parents' mistakes. I considered stamping on her soul tail, but the story about hell stopped me. I had read the catechism at Mass, and thou shalt not kill had been seared into me. But a little tap here, and a little tap there, and the tail no one else could see, grew and grew. Only I could see it, and I was thrilled. Schools of Alternative Education. I wheeled Bettina to her school. Then I walked to mine. Bettina's school dealt with serious cases, like Pig Boy, with his piggy snout, jowls, and ears, who ate from a gold plate and drank broth from a gold cup. He grabbed the cup with his chubby, cloven trotters and slurped like water splashing into a pit. And when he ate solid food, he waggled his jaws and ears, but his teeth were useless. They stuck out like a wild boar's. He looked at me once, beady eyes, a pair of inexpressive balls buried in fat. But they kept looking at me, and I stuck out my tongue so he grunted and threw down his tray. The carers came and had to calm him down, trussing him up like an animal, which is what he was. As I waited for Bettina's class to finish, I walked around the corridors of the coven. I saw a priest come in accompanied by an altar boy. Someone had given him a sheet, a soul. The priest sprinkled holy water and said that if you have a soul, God welcomes you to his bosom. To what or whom was he talking? I went closer and saw a prominent family from Adrogué. On the table, I saw a caneloni sitting on top of a silk cushion. It wasn't a caneloni, but something that had come out of a human womb. Otherwise, the priest wouldn't have baptized it. I made inquiries, and a nurse told me that every year the distinguished couple brought a caneloni to be baptized. The doctor had advised the mother not to give birth anymore, because there was nothing to be done. But they said that as good Catholics, they had to procreate. In spite of my handicap, I knew that this was disgusting, but I couldn't say so. That night, I felt so sick I couldn't eat. My sister's soul kept on growing. I was glad that my father had left. Development. Bettina was 11 and I was 12. Rufina declared, "They're at the age of development." And I imagined something coming out of me and prayed to Saint Teresita for it not to be a caneloni. I asked the psychologist what development meant, and she went red in the face and told me to ask my mother. My mother went red in the face too, and said that at a certain age, girls stopped being girls and became young ladies. Then she stopped talking and I was left wondering. I've already said that I went to a school for the handicapped, but not as handicapped as Bettina's. A girl said that she was developed. I didn't see anything different about her. She told me that what happens is you bleed from between your legs for a few days, and you have to use a pad to stop your clothes getting stained, and be careful with boys because you can get pregnant. That night, I couldn't get to sleep. I felt around the area in question, but it wasn't damp, so I could still talk to boys. When I did develop, I would never go near a boy I didn't want to get pregnant and have a cannelloni, or anything like it. Bettina talked a lot, or rather she mumbled and made herself understood. One evening during a family gathering that we weren't allowed to attend because we didn't have good enough manners, especially at mealtimes, my sister cried in her booming voice, "Mommy, I'm bleeding from my privates." We were in the room next door to the one where the festivities were being held. A grandma and two cousins came. I told the cousins not to get too close to the bleeder because they might make her pregnant. They all left offended, and mother hit us both with her pointer. I went to school and told them that Bettina was developed even though she was younger than me. The teacher told me off. We weren't to discuss immoral things in the classroom, and she failed me in morals and citizenship. The class became a bunch of worriers, especially the girls who occasionally touched themselves feeling for potential dampness. I stopped associating with boys, just in case. One afternoon, Margarita came in grinning and said it came, and we all knew what she meant. My sister abandoned her schooling in the third grade. It was no use. Really, it wasn't any use for either of us. And I left in the sixth grade. Yes, I learned to read and write, but the latter with spelling errors. And I never write the silent letters because what's the point in them? The psychologist said that I read with a lisp, but she thought that if I practiced, I would get better, and forced me to say tongue twisters, like, "Peter Piper pecked a pick of pickled peppers. If Peter Piper pecked a pick of pickled peppers, how many pickled peppers did Peter Piper pick?" Mother watched, and when I couldn't overcome my lisp, she hit me on the head with her pointer. The psychologist forbade Mother from being there during the Peter Piper. And I got better, because when Mother was there, I rushed the Peter Piper out of fear of the pointer. Bettina hummed around, opening her mouth and pointing to it because she was hungry. I didn't like to eat at the same table as Bettina. It was disgusting. She drank her soup straight from the bowl without a spoon and ate solids with her hands. She cried when I insisted on feeding her. Because of how I wasn't particular about which orifice the spoon was shoved into. They bought Bettina a high chair with an enamel tray and a hole in the seat for defecation and pee. She'd go during mealtimes. The smell made me sick. Mother warned me not to be prissy, or she'd send me to the Cotolengo. I knew that the Cotolengo was a home for the handicapped. And so my meals were, you might say, accompanied by the perfume of my sister's poo and showers of piss. I pinched her when she farted. After meals, I went out to the garden. Rufina cleaned Bettina and put her in her orthopedic chair. The Dumbo napped with her chin on her chest, or rather her breasts, because two fairly round lumps already poked out from beneath her clothes, taunting me because she had developed before me. And disgusting as she was, a young lady before me, which meant that Rufina had to change her pads every month and wash between her legs. I could take care of myself, and noticed that my breasts didn't grow because I was skinny as a beanpole, or mother's pointer. And so birthdays came and went, but I started taking a drawing and painting class, and the professor at the School of Fine Art said that I would be a major artist because I was half crazy and drew and painted like the flamboyant artists of recent times. The exhibition at the School of Fine Art. The professor said, "Yuna," which is my name, "your paintings are worthy of an exhibition. Someone might even want to buy them." I was so happy that I jumped on top of the professor with my whole body and clung to him with all four limbs, legs and feet, and we fell over together. The professor said that I was very pretty, that when I grew up, we'd court, and he'd teach me things just as nice as drawing and painting, but he wouldn't tell me any more about our plans for the moment, and they were really only his plans, and I assumed that they involved more and bigger exhibitions, so I jumped on him again and kissed him. Then he kissed me back, with a blue kiss that touched me in places I won't name because it wouldn't be decent. So I went to find a big canvas, and without drawing first, I painted two red mouths pressing, locked, united, inseparable, singing, and a pair of eyes above, blue, with fainting crystal tears. The professor kneeled down to kiss the painting, and I left him still kneeling in the shadows and went home. I told mother about the exhibition, and she, who knew nothing about art, answered that the shapeless nonsense I made on my cardboard would make the people who went to the School of Fine Art laugh. But if the professor thought otherwise, she had no objection. When I exhibited, alongside works by other students, two of my paintings were sold. One of them was the kisses, unfortunately. The professor called it first love. I thought that sounded fine, but I didn't fully understand it. "Yuna is very promising," the professor said. And I loved it every time he said it, and stayed after class to jump on him. He never scolded me. But when my little breasts grew, he told me not to jump on him, because men were fire.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.